What's up, everybody? How are you? I'm a young preacher, which means I'm easily excitable, and I like people that are excited by preaching. Are you guys ready to hear the word this evening? There you go. Dwayne told me you guys are hungry for the word, that you guys starve for it. I love that. I love that. Sean introduced me as part of your sister church, and let me be specific. We're like your baby sister church. I mean, I came in this morning and it was weird. I didn't understand what was going on. People were holding these things in their arms. They look a little bit like aliens, like little humans. See, us at the Response Church, we our age range is literally from 19 to about 22. That's where we stopped. About a year ago, my wife and I were one of two married couples. And I have had the privilege of serving with the Response Church for a while now. I'm now one of the executive pastors, or not one of them, I'm the executive pastor. That'd be crazy if you had multiple executive pastors. But I'm one of them and one of the teaching pastors. And for literally weeks now, we've been like stacking these pre-married, counseling sessions with these new people that are getting married, and it's just exciting to see the gospel working through the families. And I was here this morning, and I was pumped up just to see families in service together, taking communion, worshiping. I love that. I hunger for that. And honestly, I'm just excited. You guys have been such a faithful big sister church to the Response Church. And honestly, it's humbling for me to step on this stage. Honestly, it's like the little brother coming into the room getting to do a pep talk for the older brother. That's really intimidating for me, but you guys have been gracious. I'm excited. Dwayne and I have grown fairly close over this past year. I remember the first time I met Pastor Dwayne, and honestly, you guys, do you guys know how lucky you are? I mean, to have a solid teaching pastor like Dwayne is unreal. He's been such a good friend to me. I remember the first time I met Dwayne, or I actually didn't meet him, but when I see people on TV, I feel like I do. And he was getting interviewed on the news, and I was like, what the heck? Who's this guy? And they said he was a pastor, and then the news anchor was like, you are like the coolest pastor I've ever met. Like, tattoos everywhere, you like MMA? And I was like, that is my kind of guy. And so Dwayne and I have a lot of things in common. We both love football, except that I can forgive him for liking the San Diego Chargers. I'm a 49ers fan, which I know, Super Bowl 26, I've lost all credibility. I should just walk off the stage, right? But no, honestly, I love the San Diego Chargers too. They're my second favorite team. And actually, I would dare anybody that I probably know just as much about the San Diego Chargers as some of the San Diego Chargers' most avid fans. That's how much I love football. I love MMA. And so when Dwayne and I got to talk, we share a lot in relation with each other. But then, just to see the way Dwayne leads his family, how he pastors his family, how he's pastored you as the church, he's such a mentor to me. And literally, like, I fell so in love with Dwayne that I had to marry into the family. And so Dwayne is actually my cousin. I married his cousin for Dwayne. Really. I'm just kidding. My wife's with me. She's right there. We've been married for 2 years, and it's such an amazing opportunity to be here, especially in this time. And I believe so much that what the one thing that Dwayne and I, we love football, we love MMA, we love like everything the same. But the thing that resonates within our heart, the thing that our hearts beat for is the gospel. And so tonight I just want to dive in a little deeper and honestly, can you ever dive to the full depths of the gospel? I mean, I could get to the end of this and we still haven't gotten anywhere. And that's the beauty of it. If the gospel is like a swimming pool, you dive in and you realize that the gospel was the diving board. The gospel is the whole scenario. The gospel just goes deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And I love that. You see, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, right? Romans 1:16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes." feel recently that maybe people today have become slightly afraid of the gospel. Maybe the word gospel doesn't ring in our minds like it should, because a lot of the people I say, hey, here's a gospel truth, and they'll lay out a series of good advice. Like, here's a 12-step program that's going to help you overcome your addiction. Here's a 12-step program that's going to help you overcome your anxiety, your depression, and your pain. The gospel's not good advice. The gospel is good news, and there's a big difference. Advice talks about what we need to do, but the gospel talks about what's already been done. Truthfully, there's no amount of good deeds that you could throw on a resume to present to the Lord to say, hey, would I be okay if I entered into the pearly gates considering, you know, my resume right here? Like, here are all my good deeds. No. The gospel is the good news about what Jesus has done, not what we have done. Gospel centrality is important, not in understanding how God fits into our story, but how we beautifully fit into his narrative of redemption, rescue, and restoration, what he has done. You see, this very same gospel, the gospel that literally, the gospel that allowed you to overcome addiction, allowed you to overcome pain, allowed you to overcome sin, that saved you from the miry clay, and declared you a son and daughter of the Most High God, is the very same gospel that will sustain you, walk you through change, walk you through uncertainty and trials and suffering in this life, and it will use you for God's glory, for your good, and for ultimate persevering joy in your life. I think it's fitting to talk about this today, considering Dwayne's talk last week, right? And the state that you are in. Like, oh my goodness, what's going to happen? The lead teaching pastor is gone for 6 months. What do we do? This is uncertain. This is foreign territory. In 18 years, it's been about Dwayne being up here at the pulpit. What happens now? The same gospel. The very same gospel is going to walk you through day by day by day. It has the power to save, it has the power to sustain, and it has the power to walk you through the gates and stare Jesus straight in the face. And Paul talks about this persistent trust in the gospel in the book of Philippians. And today we're going to study Philippians chapter 2, but to really understand what is going on in Philippians 2, I need to set the framework. And so I'm going to quickly rush through Philippians chapter 1. I do not like rushing through text typically, but I believe I need to set the framework for the text that we're going to be into. Starting in Philippians 1, Paul kind of gives a status update. Hashtag gospel. Ready? Okay, he says, in verse 3, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I think Paul is in a very same situation that I am in right now. I thank God so much for you as our sister church, for you as fellow co-laborers and partakers of the gospel, that we are gathered here together, ready to dive into the beauty of what is going to be said here. Verse 6, and I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all because I hold you in my heart. For you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in defense and the confirmation of the gospel. You see, the same grace that saves you is the same grace that will sustain you. And I love that Paul is thankful that the gospel produces not only justification. Remember what Dwayne preached about 2 weeks ago? That we're justified by grace alone. And that through with faith and And I love that this justification, God's righteous declaration of our right standing before Him, is not the limit of the gospel. It just doesn't stop there. It's only part of the pie. But that same gospel that saves is the same gospel that sanctifies as we progressively become more holy, as we progressively treasure Christ and become more like Him day by day. And also, it inevitably leads to our glorification, complete holiness when Christ returns. And Paul says in verse 12, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. What is he saying here? What has happened to him? Paul is writing this letter from prison. He has a potential death sentence awaiting him. He has no idea when his trial is. He is literally, and I went to Rome and they said this is the place one time when I visited there, and we went down and they said this is likely the place that Paul wrote the book of Philippians. And let me tell you, the roof of that place was like 4.5 feet tall. So unless Paul was 3 feet tall, he was uncomfortable sitting there awaiting potentially a death sentence. Does that sound like that is a large amount of uncertainty? Like that's a large amount of, I don't know what the heck is going to happen with the rest of my life. And Paul sits here and writes, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Oh, it's crazy that sometimes I feel like when I am in a Paul-like situation, I feel like I'm in prison or I feel like there's stress or uncertainty, I usually say, what the heck, that is a barrier to the gospel. I mean, Paul could have said that. He's the guy that wrote pretty much like the majority of the New Testament. How on earth is the writer of the New Testament, the planter of the early church, how is he going to do anything sitting in prison? How is that advancing the gospel? Yet Paul says, what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Why? Because Paul trusted in God, and they trusted in that same God. They had their sustenance, their satisfaction. They trusted in His sovereignty. And Paul continues his reflection on the gospel by explaining that God's work is not hindered by persecution. God's work is not hindered by uncertainty. God's work is not hindered by suffering. God's work is not hindered by pain. God's work is not hindered by circumstance, but quite the opposite. God is using it to advance the gospel. And in verse 18, he says, what then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed. That's what he cares about. He doesn't even care about someone coming in and taking off his chains. He doesn't care about someone serving him a better meal than he had last night. He doesn't care about that. The only thing that Paul wants, whether in pretense or truth, is that Christ be proclaimed, that the gospel be made known. And in that, he says, I rejoice. Yes, I will rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. What a statement of faith. And then he says this verse, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. This is the framework he sets up for one of the most beautiful pieces of scripture in the whole New Testament. Essentially what he's saying is the only thing I care about is Christ proclaimed. The only thing that matters is that people will know the God that serves and leads me through this confusing, scary, uncertain time. And he says this, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. My friend Brad Sarian, he's the pastor or one of the teaching pastors at the Restored Church. So all these R's, man, gospel-centered fluency begins with an R, right? and he says it like this, live your life in a way that demands a gospel explanation. Like if you were to lose your job, you don't talk bad about your boss. Instead, you're gracious, you're loving, you're peaceful. If you're hurt by somebody, you're not revengeful or spiteful or resentful or angry. You're loving. You're patient. You're kind. Live your life in a way that demands gospel explanation so that when people see that you are doing something that is different than what normal people would respond, you can say it's because Jesus served me. It's because Jesus loved me. It's because Jesus was merciful to me. It's because Jesus was gracious to me. See, Paul sets this up. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. He says all of this to set up one of the most beautiful expositions of the personhood of Jesus Christ. How can one let their manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ? Paul goes into chapter 2 and shows the Christ who radiated the fullness of what the gospel is. And so today, as I read this text, will you stand with me in honor of the words that are going to be read and in belief that these are full of sustenance that are able to teach, to shape, to rebuke, correct, and train us in righteousness. Let's read from Philippians chapter 2. Verse 1 through 11. I'll read it. You don't have to read it out loud. Here it is. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. While that's talking about unity, he's saying, no, think biblically. Be of one mind. Biblical motivated thinking. What does it say? Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among you, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Yeah, amen. You guys may be seated. You see, I think one of the most beautiful parts of this passage is Paul begs the question. He says, live your lives in a way, in a manner that is worthy of the gospel. Live your lives in a way that demand a gospel explanation. Live your lives in a way that radiate the beauty of the gospel. And then what does he say? How do you do that? Like, let me set that up. He doesn't say, oh, you need to tithe all your money. You need to go to church all this amount of times. You need to do this. You need to do that. You need to start checking off all your Sunday. And you know, you make sure you go to one weekly group and blah, blah, blah. And you got to serve the Lord at least 12 times a year to be considered legit gospel-centered. No, what does he do? He says, look to Jesus. Focus on Jesus. Admire, treasure. Throw all your affections to Jesus. You see, one of the biggest attributes, and I chose that verbiage very carefully because I want to say one of the biggest. It's not exclusive, but I believe it is entirely appropriate. One of the biggest attributes that will cripple your ability to live out the gospel loud is pride. You see, everywhere in the Bible, we're told that pride goes before the fall. Pride leads to destruction, right? Pride leads to devastation. I think we all have stories where we're proud in the moment and it's led to some form of turmoil, right? Like, you're going to a swimming pool on the diving board and you're going like, check out this triple backflip, and you just do the whole thing and then you land in the pool with no pants on. I think we all have stories. No? I'm the only one? Oh, goodness gracious. All right. That's embarrassing. You see, everywhere in the Bible, we're told pride goes before the fall. Pride leads to destruction, and pride leads to devastation. But that's not it. I wish that was it. Pride is deadly. And that's biblical. Pride is deadly. And some of you maybe think, like, oh, no, that's just for the intense cases of pride, the really strong cases of pride. But what I want to show you tonight is that all pride is deadly. All pride. Timothy Keller says pride is deadly in three ways. One of the first ones he says, and I love this, is he says, pride makes you a fool. How so? Pride keeps you from ever learning from your mistakes in general. Why? Because you're always self-justifying. A proud heart is always justifying itself. It's always defensive. It's coming up with reasons why you are right, why you are legit, why you are experienced. When your relationship breaks up, or when you have a falling out with this person, or this job, or this circumstance happened and doesn't work out, what you always say is, it was them. It was him that did that. It was her that did that. It was the circumstance. No way was it ever me. And you justify yourself so that you can't learn from those mistakes. You see, we tend to shrink the cross, I think, in two ways in terms of justification. At the moment of conversion, when you recognize that you were declared right in the Lord's eyes, based upon what Jesus did on the cross, when you are converted, you've given your life to him, you've confessed that Jesus is Lord, you begin to grow in the gospel, right? And I think we shrink that in two ways. As you progress in your walk with the Lord, you realize more and more that God is holy. And as you progress in your walk with the Lord, you realize more and more how sinful you are. Can anybody relate with, like, as you grow in the Lord, all of a sudden you feel like, man, I'm a really terrible person. I feel like I'm a worse sinner now than I was back then. It's not, I think, that you're getting progressively more sinful. I think you're getting progressively more aware of your sin. It's as if Jesus is holding a fire hose and a mirror and you're walking close to it. And the fire hose is getting rid of the gunk, but you're getting closer to the mirror realizing that there's a lot of gunk left. And what we tend to do when we justify ourselves is we make less of our sin. We're saying, oh, I'm not that bad, or that God is not that holy. And we shrink the gospel. That's pride. But humble people are not always looking at themselves. They're not always standing in their own dignity. They can laugh at themselves as a result. Have you ever laughed at yourself over a stupid mistake? That's humble. And they can always learn fast, because when they do something wrong, they could focus on it and say, wow, I really messed that up. And they learn from their mistakes. Now, proud people just don't learn from their mistakes in general. They don't learn from their criticisms in particular. You know, one of the best ways to grow as a person, one of the best ways to learn is to take criticism, right? But you see, there's two forms of pride. There's a superiority form of pride, and there's an inferiority form of pride that nobody really talks about. The superiority form says that I am better than that, I am smarter than that, I have more experience than that. We all can relate to that. We all can point out people in our lives who have a superiority form of pride, but the inferiority form of pride takes things to heart too much. What they're saying is they are this type of people, and because they've labeled themselves as this type of people, they say this person can't change. And then they come face to face with the gospel, which is the ultimate changing agent of the entire world, and they say, oh, that can't change me. So they have elevated their issue and they have lowered the gospel. That's prideful, but it's inferior. Both forms of pride will keep you from learning from your mistakes and criticisms in particular. Here's how. The superiority type of pride, when someone criticizes you, you dismiss them. You don't know what you're talking about. You're not smart enough. You don't have the degrees that I do. Or, have you ever seen this? Have you ever criticized a proud person with a superiority type of pride? What happens? They'll attack you back. Have you ever seen that? Yeah, straight attack. But in the inferiority type of pride, when someone criticizes you, it so devastates you that when people even try to talk to you, you just melt down. And what happens? They can't talk to you anymore. And guess what you've done? You haven't learned from your mistakes. And because you haven't learned from your mistakes in general and your criticisms in particular, guess what that makes you? You never learn. You're stupid. You're a fool. And that's only the beginning. I may have 80% of this room, and that's only on point one. Ready? And what do I mean by it makes you a fool? I want to define that really quick so you guys don't get mad at me. What it does is you're constantly making bad choices. You're constantly choosing the wrong jobs. You're constantly in the wrong relationships. You're constantly with the wrong boyfriend. You're constantly with the wrong girlfriend. You choose all kinds of things that are wrong, but pride just doesn't make you a fool. It also makes you evil. Pride is what made the devil the devil. Pride is like a well straight to hell, like a hell well, if you will. And out from that pours forth sin and disgustingness and gunk, bitterness. Some of us, many of us, struggle a great deal with bitterness and anger. Does anybody in here? I know I do. Toward things that people have done or that people have done to us. But remember this, you can't stay angry at someone. You can't stay resentful at someone unless you feel superior to them. There is no bitterness without pride. Why? Because you're saying, I would never do that. That's superiority. Or what about paralyzing fear? High forms of anxiety. You know where that comes from? You know exactly how things have to go. You're sure you know what's best to happen in history. And when things don't happen that exact way, everything will be a disaster and you're freaking out. Why? Because you know how things have to go. How do you know? Have you ever heard this? I just know. That statement takes pride. So you can't be terribly worried without being proud, and you can't be horribly bitter without being proud. You're like, dang it. Pride leads to being opinionated. Nobody likes an opinionated person, right? My wife can attest to that. I'm the most opinionated person there is. But pride also leads to being indecisive. That's just the inferiority form. You're afraid of what other people will think of you. Therefore, you won't make a decision, and you believe in your heart that what they should listen to or think or about your solution, whatever it is legit. That's pride. It's just inferior. Pride makes you too shy. That's the inferiority form. And pride makes you too abrasive. That's the superiority form. And that's not all. Pride makes you a fool. Pride makes you evil. And I know I've got at least 95% of the room, right? Maybe 100? Not yet? Okay, fine. Pride makes you deadly. Tim Keller says it this way: pride is the carbon monoxide of sin, killing you without you having any ability to tell what's happening. It's odorless. Let me put it to you this way. You know when you're committing adultery, right? You don't just wake up in the bed and go, oh my goodness, you're not my wife. How'd you get there? You know when you're embezzling money, you don't look at your bank account and go, whoa, $300,000, where did... Does that ever happen, Dan? Like, no way. We wish sometimes. Like, could I keep it? You know when you're stealing. You know when you're talking bad about someone. You know when you're gossiping sometimes. You know when you are lusting. But many people don't know when they're proud because it's hidden. And let me show you just how inescapable it is. Joseph Epstein, in his book on pride, says so many people hate snobs. They just hate snobs. Who hates snobs here? I do. Oh, with a burning passion, I hate snobs. But you can't hate snobs unless you feel superior to them. Which means hating snobs is an ultimate form of snobbery. So you look down your nose at snobs, do you? Do you look down your nose at people who look down their nose at people? See how inescapable it is? And let me show you how it's the carbon monoxide of sin. Let me go one step further. Honestly, now, up to this point in the sermon, haven't you been thinking about a list of people that are proud? That's pride. I remember I was preaching this to my wife, and she was like, yeah, my husband's that. That's my sister. That's my mom. That's my pastor. That's blah, 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 blah. I was doing the same thing when I was writing the sermon. Then I all of a sudden realized, oh, my goodness, I'm a prideful, 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 prideful man. You see, while the prideful person has a long list of names that they've been thinking about, the humble person says, wow, I'm prideful in this way, and realizes that they are only on the pathway of humility, since the only person that is truly humble is Jesus. And honestly, next week, my pastor Joel, my head pastor from the Response Church, he's the lead pastor. We, like Dwayne, believe that Jesus is the senior pastor of the church. And so we submit to him. And Joel is going to come and give a continuation of this mini-series, if you will, on belief and the importance of belief. This message changed my life, and I encourage you to be here for it. Invite your friends, invite your family. It's a really important one. But Joel and I have had many long conversations about what is really the root of all sin. Ever thought about this? Like, what really comes first? Is it pride or is it unbelief? I was talking with Chris Sandoval this morning about that. Like, what is it? Is it like the root of all sin? Is it a proud heart or is it an unbelieving heart? And we really think that, you know, they're mutually inclusive. You can't really have one without the other. A proud heart is an unbelieving heart, and an unbelieving heart is a proud heart, right? But we're going to just default with Jesus because he's the real deal. He says in his word that the root of all sin is an unbelieving heart. But here's the truth. Unbelief, while it is the root of all sin, pride makes its bed on the foundation of unbelief. And here's how. Pride is rooted in a heart that replaces the gospel of Jesus with the gospel of self. Pride is rooted in a heart that replaces what Jesus has done, what he is continuing to do, and what he will ultimately do with what I have done, what I will do, and what I will dream about doing. That is pride. Deuteronomy 8:14 scares me to death when I read it. It says, your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God. I never understood practically what that meant until I took a job about 2 years ago as the creative arts director for a church in Oklahoma. Now, I am a white San Diego boy who loves surfing. I love craft beer. I love whiskey. Now, take that guy from California, born in San Francisco, moved to San Diego, and move him to the Midwest. Oh, I stuck out like a... Oh, my goodness. It was bad, right? But it was my dream job. We all know that pastors don't really make that much money. Oh, I made that much money in this position. It was everything I could have wanted. It was, and literally, I was a creative arts pastor at that time, and they were paying me as if I was the greatest creative arts pastor in the world. And you know what they did? They supplied me as if I was the greatest creative arts pastor in the world. They gave me a tech director, an IT director. That sounds like it's the same thing, but it's really not. They gave me a graphic designer. They gave me a stage designer. Have you ever wanted to dream what's in the mind of a creative person? Don't ever, because it is psycho crazy. Like, my mind is just, bleh. And I had a guy that built what was in my mind. So one Easter, I went up to him and said, I want a 25-foot crown of thorns that has smoke coming out of it. Can you make it rain? And can there be lightning and lights and all of that? And he's like, yeah, I could do it all. And he really did it. I had $1 million sound system, $1 million light system. I had a 156-foot stage, a full orchestra, a full choir, an insane band. I had an unlimited budget virtually. I had 60-foot screens, like five of them across the stage. I had a flying system. I can fly electric guitarist during the solo on Revelation song. I am the best creative arts director ever. And they told me, hey, we want you to just have one job. You're in charge of the experience. So anything people see, taste, touch, feel, smell, that's what you're in charge of. I was like, I can do that? You guys have paid me well to do that. And so if I was in charge of the experience, then I was in charge of people meeting Jesus. That's the stuff that came into my mind. Notice how I took good theology, and I just set it aside for a moment. I just dipped my mind in some money, and I liked it because I'm proud. Okay? Get it? Get where it's going? Okay, here we go. So, Easter came, and my 25-foot crown of thorns was legit. Like, people were running on stage, giving their lives to the Lord, and I was like, yeah, me and you, Jesus, you're my homeboy, see? I told you I'm the best creative arts director. So they're coming down, and it was great, and then all of a sudden, the experiences weren't as raw. The experiences weren't as good. People weren't getting saved, and I'm like taking the burden upon myself, like what am I doing? I'm not that good. Me. And I realize at the end of that, Deuteronomy 8:14, your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord. You see, I was a creative arts director at a mega church, a pastor, and my heart forgot about the Lord because of my pride. And because of my pride, I was fired. You're going to fire the best creative arts pastor in the world? Yeah. There's no room for pride when you are living out the gospel loud. And that was convicting to me. You see, pride is rooted in a heart that replaces the gospel of Jesus with the gospel of the self. The gospel teaches that God is infinitely satisfying. But what pride teaches is that I could find my satisfaction on my own, like money, alcohol, sex, education, job position. The gospel teaches that God is sovereign. Have you ever heard someone say, oh, God's got it under control? Do you really believe that? Come on. Like, there are people, like, seriously, the gospel teaches God is under control, but pride says, I am great. I know exactly how things need to be. And when things don't go that way, I will break out in all form of anxiety. The gospel teaches that God is full of grace. Did you know that there is nothing you can do to make him love you any more or love you any less? That's the gospel. God is gracious. But pride says, I am significant, and here's my righteous deeds that can prove it. I don't drink alcohol ever. No, not me. I don't go over 65 miles an hour on the freeway. I curb that baby at 64, right? Or what about this? I am the most generous person in the church. I tithe the most. I am the best worship leader. I'm the most prophetic. I have the best theology out of anybody in this church. Pride says, I am significant, and these righteous deeds can prove it. Paul hardcore opposes that in 1 Corinthians 13. He says, you can have all knowledge. You could be the most generous person. You could be willing to lay your life down at the stake for Jesus. But if you have not love, you are nothing. That means you could have the best theology and be totally worthless. The gospel says that God is full of grace. My righteous deeds are nothing. The only deed that is important is what he did on the cross. The gospel teaches that God is radiant in glory. Glory is like weight, the weight of who he is. His love should weigh on you. His grace should weigh on you most. His ways should weigh on you most. His thoughts should weigh on you most. But pride says what other people think, feel, or act about me is more important than what God thinks and feels and knows about me. You see, pride is the ultimate heresy, the quintessential denial of Christ, the utmost lie about who Jesus really is. So what's the answer, right? I think I've got 100% of the room. Are we all proud? Okay, good. Those of you who didn't answer, you're proud. So you may say, how can I grow in humility, right? How can I be humble? I'll tell you one thing, humility is not the answer to pride. And here's why. I've seen people say this. I am so proud, I really need to work on humility. So what I'm going to do is focus on humility so that I can be more humble, which is all about me, which is still pride. Dang it! Like, what can I do? I can't escape it. Like, if I'm proud, I can't just be humble? Like, ugh, this is so frustrating. But I do believe there's a way to grow in humility. And I want to unpack that for a second. I'm going to give it in three ways. I believe the first way is to forget yourself. The first step is forgetting yourself, or as Philippians 2 put it, empty yourself. C.S. Lewis says that Christian humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. It's not putting yourself down for the sake of trying to be humble. That's still pride, right? Oh, I'm not that great of a singer. Like, oh yeah, I can't play the bass drum and the guitar at the same time really well. I still get off a little bit, but like, come on, Sean. You're unreal. It's not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. Take the thoughts that are focused on you and focus them elsewhere. Tim Keller describes this attitude as blessed self-forgetfulness. And in our passage today, we see the spirit of blessed self-forgetfulness played out in the personhood of Jesus. Yeah, that's right, Jesus. In Hebrews 1, he's the creator. It says he's the creator of the entire world. That's a pretty important thing on your resume. That's something to be proud of. I just created everything. Like, have you seen that Ryan Regan joke where you're sitting at the table from the Me Monster and he's like, well, I walked in the moon. Jesus could just be like, oh, yeah, well, I created everything. Take a look at that. If anybody has a reason not to empty themselves, it would be Jesus, the creator of the world. And that's only the beginning. He also saved the world. Are you kidding me? The savior of the world even viewed himself rightly. In Philippians 2, 3 through 10, Paul says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. And he's saying this is the attitude of Christ. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this in mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Then it says, focus on who he is. Look, who, though he was in the form of God, had the most legit resume ever. That's my emphasis. Did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself. Some translation translated, he made himself nothing. By taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. You see, what we see is that Jesus emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. And I believe that's the second step to grow in humility, is to feed God's sheep, is to forget yourself and to feed his sheep. What Philippians 2 says is look to the interests of others. You see, the true spirit of blessed self-forgetfulness always results in you becoming a servant. Matthew 20:28, Jesus says, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. See, it always shocks me that Jesus humbled himself to the point of death. It shocks me because I can't even humble myself to the point of opening my eyes in the morning. Like, I'm sitting there in bed and I have so many eye boogers that are like gluing my eyes shut. I'm trying to open them, and the first thought I'm like, oh my goodness, I need to do this for work. Oh, I wish I would have said that in an argument the other day with my wife. Oh, I wish I could do that. Oh, I should do that. I need to do this more. I can't even humble myself to the point of opening my eyes. And then Jesus, it says, he humbled himself to the point of death. An entire life of humility. But we see that Jesus' emptying of himself had an outwardly focusing effect. Jesus' humility was for you. Jesus humbled himself to serve you. You are the joy set before him that took him to that cross. He died to serve you. And does this characterize the mission of your life? How often do you think about people? About the lost? If your life is not characterized by an unreal love for people, where you are quick to serve others, then it may be indicative that you've not emptied yourself. And that you have a pride problem. Now, I've kind of kind of worked myself into a theological conundrum right here. Honestly, I'm surprised that Pastor Dan hasn't come taking me off the stage, because essentially what I've just spit at you is total heresy. Essentially, I'm saying, I'm giving you a task. Here's how to become humble. I said there's no way you could do that at the beginning, right? Like I said, oh, church, to get rid of pride, all you have to do is never think of yourself and spend your entire life feeding others. That is totally impossible. Like, I'm a lame preacher. Essentially, what I have done is given you a complete, utter, abysmal, disgusting task and set you up to completely fail. I mean, how can someone feed people when they're so busy emptying their storehouses? That's a tension that is nearly impossible to live in. And I was talking with one of the elders at Response Church. His name's Stacy Croft, and he said one of the most beautiful things I've ever heard in regards to this tension of empty yourself and totally feeding others. He said, "We are prideful by constantly thinking of ourselves because we're trying to meet our needs. We are prideful because we constantly think of ourselves trying to meet our needs. We are humble because we no longer have to think of ourselves because all of our needs are met in Jesus." This is the gospel. In order to empty yourself and to focus on others, the answer is to think of someone else, and his name is Jesus. In order to grow in humility, the gospel truth is to feast on God, on everything that he is, to treasure him, to find your hope in him, to see him as your stronghold, your shelter in the storm, your provider, your everything. Because when you start to think of Jesus, when you start to treasure Christ, you automatically begin to grow in humility. You ask, was Jesus humble? Yeah, of course he was. He was the most humble person that ever lived. How was Jesus humbled? It was by the power of the Holy Spirit. See, humility is not about being obsessed with ourselves. Am I proud? Am I not? Am I humble? Am I not? No. It's just, let me look to him. Let me get to know Jesus. Let me fix my eyes on him. Let me live by the power of Jesus. It's like a kid that plays that imitation game where they're just, you know, trying to mimic exactly what's going on. Let me focus all my energy on Jesus and pretend, through the power of his Spirit, begin day by day, little by little, more all the time, I hope, the character of Jesus, which is humble. The answer to pride is not humility. Humility is simply a byproduct. You're really forgetting yourself and feasting on God. And honestly, if humility is about knowing your place in relation to Jesus, you kind of don't have anything to brag about, right? Yeah, he created the world. He saved the world. Oh, he saved the world by dying on a cross. And by dying on the cross, he actually defeated death by raising again on the third day. Okay, Jesus, you got me. Those are kind of legit. You see, our place is not on our throne at the right hand of God. Our place is before the throne of God, face down on our knees, where we can say something like, God, I can't bow low enough at the vision of you, my king. Paul David Tripp says it this way. The good news of the kingdom is not freedom from hardship, suffering, and loss. You see, Jesus humbled himself to the point of death on a cross. It is the news of a redeemer who has come to rescue me from myself. To rescue me from myself. His rescue produces change that fundamentally alters my response to these inescapable realities. The Redeemer turns rebels into disciples, fools into humble listeners. Remember that pride makes you a fool? Well, the Redeemer will turn a prideful fool into a humble listener. He makes cripples walk again. In him, we could face life and respond with faith, love, and hope. And as he changes us, he allows us to be a part of what he's doing in the lives of others. As you respond to the Redeemer's work in your life, you can learn to be an instrument in his hands. Isn't that a powerful quote? This is the gospel. And now, how can I testify to this? How can I testify that the good news is not freedom from hardship, suffering, and pain? The gospel is not freedom from hardship, suffering, and pain. In 2008, I graduated from Point Loma Nazarene University with a degree in ministry and a degree in biochemistry. I know that's awkward. Those two don't really work out well together, you know what I'm saying? Actually, but it's really helped me. And I was really excited about the ministry that God was stirring in my heart, and he gave me a rock star wife. Like, honestly, she was the ministry wife of all ministry wives. She had blonde hair, blue eyes. She was about 5'7". She had a walk like no others. I'm talking about her walk with Jesus, okay? But both. I was being, yeah. Okay, and she loved the Lord. She radiated faith. She radiated hope. She radiated the gospel. And I was a multi-instrumental worship leader, so wherever there was a hole, I would fit in. But she was also a multi-instrumentalist as well. And every Sunday, she would show up with her skinny jeans, her high heels, a perfect stool, and she sat on the stool, crossed her legs, got out the thick strings, the bass guitar, and she would put that down and be like, "Baby, I'm ready." Boom. Oh my goodness. That's everything a worship pastor can ever hope for. Everything. We took the church from about 30 people to 300. Our life groups were radiating with the beauty of the gospel, lived out, played out. It was amazing. And our church kind of looked at us as that couple that's kind of gross, you know, the couple that makes you want to go. And so we would always do these cute romantic things together. And on one Sunday, I decided I was going to lead worship in our first service, and then I got someone to cover me in second service because she was thinking I was going to do a whole Sunday. So if I swept her away in the middle, she had no idea what was coming, right? And this was our 2-year anniversary. I did that. I rented an amazing, amazing cabin in this vineyard. We both loved wine, and so why not place us both right in the middle of a vineyard? And it was glorious. Have you ever walked into a hotel lobby and the beauty of that lobby just took your breath away? Like, that's exactly the moment. Like, we walk in and it's like, The issue is that Jamie suffered from a genetic disease called cystic fibrosis. And she had a tenth of the lung capacity that normal humans do. And upon walking into the honeymoon suite, if you will, of our 2-year anniversary, she collapsed on the ground and her lungs failed her. I remember freaking out in that moment, like, oh my goodness, what do I do? So I grabbed her up, put her in the car, because I was sure that I could get to the hospital faster than an ambulance can. Pride. And so get her in there, and they're putting all these things into her body and, you know, oxygen tubes on her face. I didn't know what was going on. It was a little bit different. I mean, sure, we'd dealt with this disease before, and she'd been in and out of the hospital, but this time was different. So I didn't know what was going on, and they took an x-ray and said, I've never seen anything like this. This needs to go up a little bit higher. So 15 days after that, I mean, serious medication. It was scary. We had to have some conversations, and she started getting a little bit better, and it was like, okay, whew, she can come home. Great. What a 2-year anniversary, babe. And I remember on day 15 or so, we snuck some wine into the hospital because we really loved wine, right? And so we were having that with some friends from the church and in our life group, and they sent them off, and I went to go kiss my wife and kiss her goodnight, and I kissed her, and it was one of those really just romantic kisses. It's like, oh my goodness. And she said, wow, that took my breath away. I was like, don't say that. And like, all of a sudden, I just started freaking out, like, oh my goodness, like, is she being honest right now? What the heck's going on? And then I saw the blood pressure start going down, her pulse started going down, everything started beeping, and I was like, ah! I ran out, grabbed the doctors, they came in and said, this is it, Ronnie, her lungs are going to collapse, we need to intubate her right now, put her on life support. I was like, I was just kissing her. Like, what's going on? Are you serious? So they rush her into ICU. They put all this stuff in there. And before I knew it, she was totally unconscious. I couldn't say hi. I was like, you never told me that. So I'm sitting there in absolute uncertainty, not knowing what was going to happen with my wife. And like, I felt like Paul in prison. Like, this is killing me. This is uncomfortable. I don't like this. God, what are you doing? And so I started praying, for the glory of your gospel, will you raise her from the dead and prove that you are in control? And so I was just like, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my goodness. So by God's grace, he put her on the top of the lung transplant list. The issue is, lungs never came. Like 15 days went by, and at the top of the lung transplant list, you're going to get a lung sometime, right? 15 days goes by, and I'm like, God, what the heck? Are you not listening to my prayers? And I remember having a conversation with Jamie. If the doctors say this, and this happens, and this happens, and here's the checklist, I want you to sign my life away. I am okay with you signing my life away. And it came down to that moment. The doctors brought out the papers. I'm bawling my eyes out. And tears don't look good on carbon paper. They just really don't. And I'm about 1 inch away from signing, shaking, like terribly, terribly shaking. And I breathe, and I start lowering my pen, and the doctor says, wait, wait, we got lungs. And I was like, thank you, Jesus. And I took the pen and I threw it like across the hospital. And I was like, glory to God, you're the best. And literally got everybody from the church. They rushed her into a 9-hour surgery. We had like 60 people in the waiting room. We were playing songs and we were singing and we were eating together. And it was such a glorious moment of communion. God was thick. His spirit was present deeply in the midst of this community of believers that was faith-filled. And the surgery went great. She was out that night, and I got to sneak in, and I remember sitting there and putting my head on her chest for the first time and feeling for the first time my wife actually taking full breaths and imagining, wow, she was a legit singer with 10% lung capacity. She's going to be Whitney Houston times 50 with 100%. And so I was just so excited, and there had been a nurse that was assigned to Jamie, and I said, I can't wait for you to meet my wife and see her beautiful blue eyes. And went home that night, and I talked to her parents and brought her parents in the next morning, just really excited about what God was doing. And we walked in through the doors, and one of the nurses was like, oh, hey, Ronnie, have you seen the doctor yet? And I was like, no, I'm just going to see him right now. Oh, okay, make sure you talk to him. He's like, that's kind of weird, whatever. And the doctor came up and said, Ronnie, I need to talk to you. Last night, a blood clot went to your wife's brain and exploded. I was like, oh, that's no big deal. You put lungs in her yesterday. Like, so, you know, you could fix that, right? Like, that's cool. Like, and she's a fighter. I mean, she's survived like 30 days in the hospital, like, and against all odds. And I was like, what are the chances of her surviving something like that? 0%, Ronnie, she's gone. And I just remember this falling on the ground. Like, you'll never understand the weakness of knees when you hear as a 25-year-old male that your companion, your ministry all-star, is gone. God, how on earth can you be in control? You didn't see what we did for you? 30 to 300 people, God. Lives changed. What on earth are you doing? And I remember bawling my eyes at the side of her bed. And my brother Ryan came up for me. He said, Ronnie, God loves you and he is in control. You see, when I was in third grade, I had a full recognition of the weight of my sin and knew exactly what Jesus did on that cross to pay the penalty for the foolishness that I was. That same gospel truth that lifted me out of the miry clay, that saved me from the pits of hell, is the same gospel truth that Ryan preached over me that day. And I can't tell you the impact it had on my life. There's something about knowing that it's not about me. I don't need to know the future. I don't need to know all these single steps. I don't need to know every single way. I don't need to know that I'm going to get better or happy or blah, 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 or all of this. The only thing I need to know is that God is faithful. He is true. He is loving. He is great. He is glorious. He is gracious. He is more satisfying than anything that you could ever have anywhere. Jesus is everything. Something tells me you guys know a little bit about that. But do you believe it? Has the gospel taken that deep of a root in your heart that no matter what may come your way, you can say, I believe, I stand on the foundation of that gospel, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes to forget about myself, forget about my life, and to feast on everything that he is. That's how Paul David Tripp's able to say, the good news of the kingdom is not freedom from hardship, but it's the news of a redeemer who could rescue me from myself. That same gospel, the same God who rescues and restores and renews, helped me to marry that woman right there and look her in the eyes and say, I love you more than anybody. Believe me, I loved Jamie more than anybody. But that's the power of the restorative energy of the gospel. That is what we stand on. That is what Paul was standing on. You see, there's two ways that pride is dealt with. Isaiah 12 says, for the Lord of hosts has a day against all that is proud and lofty, all that is lifted up, and it shall be brought low. That's terrifying. If our pride is like an anvil, it is meant for our own heads and it will crush us in hell. But by God's grace, by God's faithful, amazing, and loving grace, he took that anvil up and he dropped it on his son. Wait, are you kidding me? The most humble person in the entire world took the punishment for the most proud. That is the first humble thought you will ever have in your entire life. And he emptied himself. He took the punishment for you, to serve you by his grace. You see, the Lord has opponents, those who are proud, but he has no rivals. And at the cross, he has vindicated his name, the name that is above all other names. And he has made us right with him. The only way we receive grace, the only way we receive freedom from pride, is because of the undeserved disgrace of Jesus. And I love this. Your pride, no matter what circumstance you're going on in life, is decisively defeated at conversion. The moment you recognize what Jesus took on the cross was meant for you, and that all of righteousness has been given to you because of that sacrifice. What a beautiful concept. That's what's called salvation, conversion, justification. And then it's progressively defeated in sanctification. The more you become like him, the more you treasure Christ, the more you look to him, the more you feast on God, your pride will be progressively defeated, and one day it will be totally defeated in glorification. The moment you are staring Jesus face to face, your pride will be no more. See, the Bible's answer to our fallen self-obsession is a superior satisfaction in God. And that satisfaction in God is what will enable you to endure anything and know that for the sake of the gospel, that is for your good and for your ultimate joy. Because then he becomes our sole obsession, our sole affection, and we become his treasured possession. And there's nothing like being called a child of God. Do you agree with that? That is such a profound statement. Victory over pride is the grace of the Father by the Son's sacrifice given to the children, to his children, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to empty ourselves, to forget ourselves, to feed others, and to feast on God. You want victory over that pride? Feast on God. Feast on him, because Jesus is everything. Let's pray.